sentiments or expectation without any defined expectation at the beginning. So it's critical to do that. The second one is understand the building where you want to, how you want to manage your building or the business environment where you want to operate. And it's also very important to do that, because if someone says you should deliver certain level of performance and you don't understand
that's where the third stage is where you are defining whether you want to do a
to your office and do everything, and as soon as everything is going to work, Manage the assets you want to manage, it's not competency, you also want to understand, you know, their mentality, what kind of human being they are. So you also do that in HR or not, just yourself. I don't need that HR to do that. Need yourself, because you want to be able to be in your house. You don't want to get a call at 12 midnight because your technician refused to, was sleeping, or your technician refused to come to work. Or your job, you know, instead of just shutting down water, when water was overflowing, you forgot to shut down and your place is flooded. Or you forgot that the problem with the flow switch and it didn't tell you that the water overrun the open building. They call you at 1 a.m. and your building is flooded. So you need to understand the kind of human beings. So these are critical elements, for you to be able to create your next business, which is the plan. And I said, by putting your plan, by getting all these details, and then you go to individual departments, and are relevant to your business, supply chain, procurement, finance, and HR. Understand the systems and the business, how you hire people, how you fire people, how you get money, what's the purpose of getting money, are we making money? Actually, a lot of people get money, are we making money? Because there's a difference between having, you know, your profitability as a business, but you don't have cash. So all your business, all your operations are based on payment later, paid later, those payments. You have a lot of people owing you, and then they owe you, they know you have cash to transact. As I know, the MMC, we had categories of transit. We had passenger service charge as transit. For those who don't know, passenger service charge, everybody is flying all over the world, not only in Nigeria. The terminal that you are flying through charges the airline an amount, like abroad is $10. In Nigeria, it used to be 1,500. I don't know whether they changed it now. It used to be 1,000 and it took to 1,500 per passenger. So each airline is supposed to pay the terminal operator. So MM2, MM1, for that called the airport, too far, they are supposed to be paid an amount from number of passengers and the process, so that they can use it to maintain. Have your service charge, like a service charge, to run the building and manage a commercial building. So that's why they call it passenger service charge. So we have over 500 million outstanding. The airlines are collecting the money, but they were not repeating. They are not paying. They are not paying the terminal. We go down the line, we have to now start, for those who have flew through MM2 in the past 2009, 2008, 2009, 2010, find out that we have to now create our own team. As you are climbing up to go to the final departure, we have people collecting money. Your passenger service charge is not collected directly by us. Because other airlines are not paying us that money, we are owing a lot of money. The second was, you know, service charge for the building. And some people are not paying rent. So they are supposed to pay rent to use our facility. We are not fans. We are not in a private terminal. You take an office in our terminal, you have to pay for the office. And you pay the service charge, you know, going with it. So we have two in our access to share my screen. So, any questions so far? Show evidence. financial, you know, reports, financial reports that shows this is how much you should have been spending. If this generator is functional, but this is how much you are spending today, and this is what we have lost in the last 3 years trying to run this generator by force. Well, that generator is dead. And if you continue that way, the cost may even increase. And this is what the projection will be in the next 3 years if you continue to run it this way. So we are better off buying a new generator. Then you will have gone also to your procurement, you have to talk to the generator company. Can we do a trade-in? Can we take this old generator, what value, 1 million, whatever it is? If we cannot trade it, let's find someone who can buy. All those things, analysis you have done, can we do a 3 months or 6 months payment? So when you are doing a presentation and discussing, you already gone beyond just telling them the generator is not functional, we need to buy. And people are going to listen to you. I've asked questions where my own issue is not even generator has gone down, is that generator is over capacity. So I've had like 3 or 4 or 5 buildings that we took over. And the first thing we always do is the one I talked about, our process is that way. Do an audit and determine what the equipment we have, whether they are correct or not, correctly rated or overrated. And we went to the client and I said, your generator is over capacity. So it's a building that I still managing today. When I took over the business, I did an audit and we discovered that we have 2 generators. One was 750 kVA, the other was, I can't remember, but it's very high. Today we're using 320 and 280 kVA in that site. And at the time I took over in 2012, they had like 3 times the capacity of the generator. But the client said, no, the generator has been there. And I showed them evidence what you're losing in terms of diesel consumption. And eventually they said, okay, sell them. And before we even did, because we've already gone to market, tell me how much we're going to get from the value, how much they need you want. So when we're doing a presentation, we're doing a comprehensive. And they give it go ahead. There was another one that the client said, okay, we don't believe you. But they have people within the estate who also have the knowledge of energy. And they, you know, install an equipment themselves. So for 1 week, and they came back to us and said, we agree. We had another company that generator was running down. They wanted to overhaul. I advised against overhauling. And I gave them a proposal. What kind of generator should they buy? We have 3 generators. 805 kVA, and I recommended that you buy different models, different configurations, and tell them that it's not cheap. They've even approved the payment for overhauling. They've done one. At the time I was having that engagement with them, and I told them it doesn't make sense to continue this. They're throwing money away. Even the one we've done now, in 3 months, we're already spending more money. And they told me no, they were not interested. I left them. I didn't push for that. We did the second generator. And the same thing that happened on the first generator started happening. They were the one that called me themselves and apologized for not listening to me. And it's a global company. I got an email from their London office, their technical team, and apologizing and they should have listened. And they now agreed to make all the changes we recommended. So if you don't show evidence, there are clients that will say we are not. But show them evidence. Let them see. Then they are the one that will call you back to say go ahead and do it.
Yes, it does. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Your hand is
up. Okay, good morning, sir. Good morning, class. I during your discussion, you made mention of the facility condition assessments, and at a point in time, you made mention of the facility audits. I want to confirm if these two... Is it okay? That's what I want to confirm.
Yeah.
We can be using
packaging. Condition assessment is the same thing as facility audits.
Okay.
It's only the way we use it. Yeah.
Okay.
Most of the people say the odd. Hello. Planning the space of the head of battles external. We did another review around, we did around us, and we found out that we're doing 30-40% of the market rate. So we need to now change our rate, and we're providing the high level of service. Nobody was doing anything. All our tenants were just having fun. We need to do a change, and we communicated the change, increase, you know, the amount of money the business can generate, you know, from rent. We talk about workforce supply and cost. Some of them mentioned also, these are things you do with your supply chain people. So, on that budget, you know, just talk generally, five key things to move on the budget. Which is also important when you're doing your strategy plan. Because your strategy plan is not just document, it also includes financial. How much are you going to spend in 2014, 2024, how much are you going to spend in 2025? It's part of the report you're going to share with management so that they know that you are creating, you have a long-term look, and they start saying, okay, yeah, why not? We can plan for that. We need to replace all the lifts because the lifts are old, and because lifts cost you about 100 million to replace, and you put it in 3 years time to give the business opportunity to raise the money to pay for it. Still functional today, you can see management costing you pay, but you feel that it can be more efficient. You are consuming energy because you have the old model, the mechanical delivery, not the electronic delivery. So nobody is going to fight you. You say 3 years time we need to replace it. And you show evidence that you're always going to save the next 3 years to be able to fund from the facility point of view and going forward. So we did a building 5 years ago. We discovered the building where we have, you know, bidding actually. We discovered that the building was already spending. Somebody is disturbing the class. Listen to your sister. We saw that the company was spending about 100 million or thereabouts, or more thereabouts, on energy. And we did an audit during the process of our getting ready to what is happening. And saw that we can save more than 36 million a year. We make some changes to the way the building operates, the way the building is drawn, the kind of installations and equipment that are in the building. And we included it in our proposal. We even put a caveat that we are ready to, because we went to our vendor before we did the presentation, who are some of those assets. Please mute yourself so that you don't stop the class. And we got a proposal from the vendor to say, two of them, actually, one of them was ready to fund because they have a partnership with OEMs and they're ready to do the installation and get paid after installation. So the client is not going to commit any money at the beginning. The second vendor was ready to work with us over 3 years and get paid over 3 years. Whatever installation change was to make to the building. And then we included it in our presentation to the client because they were sweet. They were happy. So these are things that, you know, looking at the past financial systems can help you to understand what changes you can make. In fact, current one and how much are you spending on it? What changes? So that helps you to also look at what you tweak, what are you going to get? You have a team, you need to have an engagement for every unit of your operations. In a big project or in a big job you're doing where you have they've been there before you arrive with your problem engagement and understand, you know, what from their point of view. And I did ask when I was 11, for instance, 11 to, I asked all the senior people, for lack of a better word, to assume that they are the facility manager of the airport and come and do a presentation on how they manage the airport on their own individually, not even in group work. And all of us came together in a session, the whole team. Facilities department in MMP and listen to everybody one after the other. What do they see? How do they see the airport? What do they think we can do differently? And from there, we learned a lot. We adopted some of the ideas that came from the presentation in our strategic document we shared basically with the to improve the airport operates. So these are, you know, things that your eyes cannot see. So these are, the things you to be able to ensure that you are, you're operating at a level. We talked about sourcing last week. If you have any questions, you can ask me if I just go through, I just want to run through before we go into our name proper. So where I'm waiting for a hand or somebody to talk, until I'm sharing my screen. This is ISO 14012 sourcing process. FM ISO 14012 is one of the new ISO standards that was advocated for FM to ensure that everything we do in FM is the same. So you can see, understand the business environment is always there, align with the business strategy. One of the reasons to conduct this assessment, specify requirements. Identify certain qualities and measurable results. Assess the risk and cost of options. Make a business case. Choose a sourcing method. Buy internal resources or procure external resources. Set performance criteria. Monitor, control, and continuously improve services. You see where, you know, we had a debate last week about buying. You don't see anything here that says that we all buying the service. This is a sourcing process for FM. Our responsibility, these are our responsibilities that are defined there. So, place where sourcing comes in, you choose a sourcing method. It's not say hire vendor. I mean, did you see the project say hire a vendor? No. Or buy a material? No. Choose a sourcing method. Or choose a sourcing method, it's based on your understanding of the industry, the business, what you're supposed to deliver. Then you choose whether you want to outsource or insource. And you go to procurement and hand over, this is our source. You'll find the vendors, but you'll have specified everything that you require the vendor to deliver on, the expectation, the service area you want, the specifications, most times facility, your procurement, sourcing. My FM service in Nigeria is terrible because the clients, and some of you are part of that client, just send email to vendors and they come and do an inspection and send us your proposal after inspection, which is nonsense. Everybody, three people go, they will not see the same thing. You're supposed to specify the requirement, you're supposed to give them details, you're supposed to be able to do a tender without anybody visiting any. Because you provide all the information that is required, and I've done two tenders on that in this company, where the client actually specified the site visit is not required, because all the information you need has been provided. And that's the standard. And those information provided are provided by the FM, not procurement. It's not procurement. It's procurement that is sending the RFQ out, but the requirements have been put together by FM. So that's why you talk about specified requirements. And identify service quality and measurable results. Those are information that goes into RFQ. I don't know whether anybody has hand up.
Sorry, sir. Please, could you repeat that statement regarding when you bring in the vendor to come and inspect and inspect the nonsense? What's the appropriate way to do it?
That's what I'm saying. You have to specify. Okay. You have to specify. So there are two. Look at number four on the process flow that you are seeing on my screen. Specify requirements. Yes. Identify service quality and measurable results. That's what you need. So if somebody says, come and give us AC maintenance service, and you have the vendor to come and do an inspection, what do you want the vendor to come and see? Come and see that your AC is 2 horsepower and they are 20 units. And I've seen that for God knows how long in this country. And you now go on and on, and your procurement process is supposed to be 3 months or 4 months, become 1.5 years. Because you get proposals, it's not correct, you send it back to them, you ask them to go and redo it. Some even will do, they will use all vendors' proposals, they feel that, okay, this one speaks a bit to what we want. They will remove all the figures there and send it to everybody else to put. And people say, we didn't see this when we came there. Okay, do you want to visit again? Or should we just say, oh, no, this is, you know, go back and forth. But I already, you don't get any results. You send it to my memory, we come to it. It doesn't make sense. You can do that without anybody coming to sign at all. And that's our role as facility managers. You work in an organization that needs to outsource. Your job is to specify, provide all the details required. You have asset register. You've done conditional assessment. You have all the information in the building. You should be able to provide the capacity of the generator, the number of hours, the details of repairs that have been carried out on the generator to assist the vendor to code. You don't need the vendor to come down and start working around at all.
Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for the interview.
Yeah, any other questions?
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Equipment,
sir, like you actually just mentioned, which I actually agree to, that the vendors don't really necessarily have to come to site. But yet, we still find out that at work, vendors still always request to come to site. Because even after giving them all the specification, okay, for instance, my sludge pump, that's for the sewage. I just want to paint a scenario. Now,
yeah. The
vendor, I give him the size of the pump and then what he wants to do. And he's going to complain after making proposals that, oh, we didn't open the sewage. I didn't see the pump myself. We just told. So most of them always feel like, oh, you didn't let me see it. Oh, you didn't allow
any
me
vendor,
to
any pump. Vendor that's telling you that is not competent. You don't need a vendor.
Okay, thank you.
That already tells you that the vendor doesn't know what he's doing.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to clarify on.
So let me paint you a scenario. So you are holding an equipment from Germany or London or US. The client, the sourcing company, the company there, we only have to wear them details. They will not find anybody to Nigeria to come and check where you want to install. They assume that you have provided them all the information required to specify or even to be able to determine what you require and send to you and ship it to you. If you don't provide and they ship based on what you have provided and it doesn't work, then it's your cut. But if the client, if the supplier, which is now your vendor, says that I need to come and see, then the person doesn't know what they're doing. It's not technical. Probably a seller, you know, who has no technical team. And that's part of your requirement to hire a vendor for a technical service. The person must have technical teams who, when they get the specification, they can quickly know that, okay, this is a, you want one component of the specification. If there are three items on the spec, they see two, they can know what the third one is. They don't need to come to site. If you give them a sum pump configuration, they should be able to tell you the size of the sum for your sewage, your lift station. Because the capacity of your pump is determined by the size of your lift station. So I'll be able to tell you, okay, your lift station should be about 20 cubic meters or 10 cubic meters, as case may be. So if they can't do that, then they are not the kind of person you want to use. You don't have any clue about what you're doing, and you shouldn't use them because they'll make your life difficult. You want to paint, you ask the painter to come around and look around. What is coming to you? Give him the square meter of your wall. What you want to paint? And specify the paint you want. Let him give you a cost. Because every paint manufacturer tells you how much spread of paint. And from there you can determine the quantity of paint you require. So, I don't see the reason why somebody is okay and need to come and walk around. When he walks around, what is he doing? He's using his eyes to measure how many paints you're going to use on the wall. How? And I don't need to charge you, but I charge you because they're not using any
scenarios. For example, you have, let's say you have a generator and a backup generator, and one breaks down, and maybe for the while you were running, you're running off one of the generators. So you yourself as the FM, you are not certain of what is wrong with the generator. Is it not necessary for you to call the professionals to come and probably check and analyze what could be wrong with it? Without them saying, okay, my generator is bad, and expecting them to tell you what is wrong. So I want to know in terms of
let me give you an example.
Okay,
so you have a process in your company. What we call request management. So request management means that anybody who needs a request must specify what they need.
Okay.
You either do it manually by email or by call, or you do it through a software. If somebody calls you and says my AC is not working, what questions are you going to ask the person for you to know the kind of repair you are coming to, the kind of work you are coming to do? You will ask questions that will lead you to understand what is wrong with the AC, isn't it?
Yes, sir.
Do you need to first go send a technician to go and see the AC? The engineer will come back, carry tools and materials and go back and fix. That's what you are saying. No, that's not correct. That's not FM.
Yeah.
In your team, you have a generator. In your team, the facility manager is not Mr. Know-All. In your team, you cannot have generators. We have without having a technical person in your team who is responsible for generator. You don't need a vendor to come and tell you that, okay, generator crankshaft is broken. Without opening the engine. Because the guy may want to sell. You know, I tell people, you want to buy a generator, you're asking the OEM supplier to come and specify the capacity you need. I can assure you for free that the guy is going to give you capacity beyond your requirement. He probably has generators that have been lying fallow in his building. I just give an example of a building. He has 750 kV generator that I'm currently using 280 and 320 kV generator to run for the past 8 years. And before then, it was 750 kV that was there. But if I call it an OEM to come and specify for me, he will tell me, okay, replace with another 750. So you can't say because the generator is technical, so therefore, you must have a technical person. So for you to know the generator is not working, so you can't say my generator is shut down, I don't know what's wrong with it. Is it smoking? Is it cranking? Is it something and shutting down? Those are things, even if the guy who is coming to send somebody to you, who you call a vendor, they will still ask you questions so that they will know whether it's an electrical person they're going to send or a mechanical person. Don't forget, when they are sending somebody, they're going to charge you. And these are costs that you have to factor in your life, and you ask yourself, does it make sense? So, not to understand, not to have somebody. So, I'll give you another scenario. We had incoming for those who have electrical background, breaker, main breaker. Building packed up one of our client spaces. This was about 4 years ago. Because everything was working, but there was public power, generator was operating, but it wasn't delivering. Because the incoming to the building was not engaging. And we were able to determine that the problem is. But it's not something that you can fix. You know, major components, and you can't stock it. Change over main breaker. I call it main breaker or incoming main breaker. It's not a component that goes bad in the life of the building. It goes bad maybe once in 10 years or 20 years. And you know what the client asked me is that, why don't I have a senior engineer on site? And I said, can you please mute yourself? Whoever is making this noise. So, and the client says, why don't I have a senior engineer? And I ask the client, what would the senior engineer be waiting for an equipment that's not designed to fail? That the possibility of failing is 1/1,000. But I will hire somebody waiting on time for that to happen. And in 10 years, the guy has no job to do. And you are paying him. And the guy said, okay, I'm sorry. How long is it going to take to fix it? And I gave them the time, and we're able to do that within 4 hours. So, those are things that you cannot be a mechanical, electrical, and civil at the same time. Or a building manager at the same time. No. You have members of your team who is responsible for various components of your service, who are supposed to be factual, who are supposed to be detailed, who are supposed to understand what goes on. You yourself should be able to ask the question and say, what is wrong with this generator? Do you have a general understanding? So the guy says, okay, generator, you go there and you see it yourself, you understand. So even when the vendor comes back with a proposal, you are not just relying on your technical team. You also have an idea to say, okay, this is solve the problem. Because don't forget, your management is not going to have the vendor or have the technical team, what is wrong with the generator, or what solution you are putting in place to fix it. They are going to ask you. So if you assume because you are not technical, you won't have a general understanding. Yeah, you'll be doing yourself no favor. But it doesn't mean that you should cause the vendor to come and tell you what is wrong. That's where I'm going. I hope that answers your question. So that people have hands up. Mr. Folonjo, I don't want to see you have your hands up. If you want to ask another question, back up Folonjo. Okay, Folonjo. You can go on, please.
Okay, thank you, sir. Please, with your respect, I would like to recall you back to the first slide that you shared in this section. This is strategic planning ISO 41011. So the strategic level, tactical level, and operational level. I would like to have a quick glance on the slide again, sir. Sorry for the call, but
I believe that the point of this class is for you to have knowledge, not
Yes, I still have my hands up, and I want to, on behalf of the whole class. You gave us an assignment at the early stage in 2020, and from all indications, because the environment could not allow us to do the assignment. So we are pleading that for the exam over 100, or you give us something else as assignment within this short while so that we can accomplish.
Don't worry your life. I will share with you next week.
The way, sir.
We're going to score for the year.
Okay. I'm grateful. I know. So I just, because my classmates are afraid, and I told them that.
Nobody should be afraid of anything.
Thank you so much, sir.
Don't be afraid.
Thank you, sir.
We appreciate you. We enjoy your class.
Thank you, sir.
You have a nice day. Enjoy the rest of your weekend.
And you too, sir.
You too, sir.
Make sure you are a professional because don't do haphazard. Don't do things for the fun of doing them. Pay attention to yourself. Learn. Ask questions. Draw the resources at your disposal. People, materials, knowledge online. And be the best you can be. You have a nice weekend. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye-bye. 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 Bye-bye.